everybody. Happy belated Thanksgiving and welcome to A Case of the Jills. I want to get right into the topic today. In a lot of the emails I get, some of the themes repeat themselves. And one of the themes that I come across a lot is a real sense of anxiety about decreasing exercise and decreasing fitness as a result of that. For many of us that are suffering from either overtraining syndrome or amenorrhea, we need to decrease the amount of training that we're doing in order to get healthy again. And this causes us a lot of frustration. We're nervous about this for a lot of different reasons, and I thought today it would be important to address it. So like anyone who puts a lot of effort into anything, the last thing we want to do is see the good work that we've done kind of like go away. It's taken many of us a lot of years to get to a point where we were either running a certain mileage, running a certain speed. Let's say if you're a bodybuilder competing at a certain level, triathletes the same. And it's really hard for us to think of the fact that when we decrease or even stop exercise, we're gonna be losing all of this hard work. Being honest, for a lot of us, the body that resulted from the hard work that we were doing, irrespective of the fact that the methods by which we attained that body were not healthy, that body image is also a compelling factor. Again, being totally honest. For a lot of us, the amount of work that we had to do to achieve a certain level of, let's say, performance in our sports, gave us this smaller, leaner body. We have equated this body with our level of success, our self-esteem, and a million other things, and so we don't want to let go of that. At the beginning of this process, it is something I would safely say will cause anxiety for almost anyone. I know I went through it myself. I was definitely concerned about detraining. I had gotten to a certain point where I was running a certain number of miles every week, and I enjoyed that very much. There are many underlying reasons why I enjoyed the level of training that I had. One of them definitely was that I used all of that time out there on the road or on the trail as a coping mechanism for some other issues in my life that I didn't want to address. This, of course, this sort of usage of physical activity as a coping mechanism is the subject of another video. But for today, we are going to talk about that anxiety that comes from detraining. I also had attachments to this sort of body shape that I had attained by training as much as I was. I was afraid of detraining and losing fitness, my definition of fitness at the time, in order to get healthy. One thing I want to get out of the way right at the beginning is the following. If you are questioning whether or not you actually have to lose fitness or will lose fitness in your journey to recover, you have to keep this in mind. Your body is where it is right now because of the fact that you have not given yourself adequate time to recover between efforts and you have not supported yourself with adequate nutrition. You cannot continue to train at the level that you're training and assume that the situation is going to get better. You also cannot think that it's okay to assume that you can eat more to compensate for your level of physical activity. I made a video about this before, that it's really difficult to consider the fact that you could eat your way out of overtraining and/or amenorrhea. It doesn't really work that way. I'm gonna link that video down below if you wanna check it out for yourself. Suffice it to say, the way to healing is actually to detrain. You have to get your mind around the fact that you're going to have to decrease what you consider, by the way, in this very narrow definition that we have of fitness, we think of fitness as something very specific, that you are going to have to step away from that a bit in order to give your body adequate chance to recover. In this sense, we have to stop thinking of detraining as something to fear and look at it as something that is one of the major steps on the way to healing. Detraining is actually going to help us get better. And while it is true that there are a lot of physiological processes that do decline when we stop training as much as we were, there are many positives to this process of losing fitness, or let's call it detraining today. So I had to ask myself as I started this process, what did I think I was going to do in terms of my training long term? I had gotten to a point where I was running a certain number of miles a week, as I said, and so I tried to think, like, what was I thinking back then about how long I could maintain that level? How did I think it was possible to maintain that forever? Where did I think the cutoff was? What was I looking at 5, 10, even 20 years down the road? You know, I think that if I look back, I naively saw women who were running at ages much, much more advanced than mine. So they were in their 50s or 60s and still running. And I think that I just automatically assumed that that would be part of the deal for me. I would just be able to do it. I thought that eventually maybe at some point I would decrease mileage a little bit, or maybe I would consider this crazy thing all the cool kids are doing called periodization of training. I just thought I would be one of those people that could just run forever. Of course, it wasn't realistic. Two things that I never really considered was the fact that many of those women who were running in their 50s and 60s were not women who were running at that high level in their 20s and 30s and 40s. The second thing I never considered was the fact that those women probably took off not just months, but years of running in the middle. To be able to achieve this longevity, one must take time off, whether it is for a career or having children or for whatever reason. Lots of women take years off in the middle, and I just never thought of that. It was definitely fantasy land to assume that I would be able to run at that level forever, even as a healthy person, never mind someone who was kind of like, okay, not kind of, definitely not healthy. Okay, so are there any positives to this whole detraining situation? Well, turns out that yes, there are. If you look at the studies that have been done on athletes that are going through a phase of detraining, we see that skills such as riding your bike or swimming, etc., are things that are stored in your long-term memory. So you absolutely will not lose your ability to do those things. That type of motor memory stays with you forever. Also, it turns out that if you've been training for a very long time, you will hold on to your residual fitness longer than someone who just started training. I know that when I came back from running after taking 2 months off, it took me almost no time to get back up to the point where I could train for a 50K. It was definitely much less time than if I was a newbie runner starting out for the first time. Another great thing is that it turns out that endurance fitness actually lasts longer than, let's say, a sprinting effort or something that requires heavy lifting. There is a book called Exercise Physiology that I took a look at to gain some more information about this whole aspect of detraining. I'm gonna also link to this book down below. It talks about something called the restoration principle. It says that after a period of detraining, the speed at which you can recover your fitness is dependent on several factors: age, experience, sleep, nutrition, hydration. And considering the fact that this detraining cycle is a period where you are going to be resting a lot, eating a lot, and drinking a lot of water, I would say you're set up for success when you come back. Also, there was a study that was done in Japan that was published a couple of years back by a guy named, oh god, I need to look this up, Ogasawara. It was in the Journal of Applied Physiology. The study was actually done on bodybuilders, but I think that a lot of it can be applied to other types of exercise. The idea is that muscles lose their ability to respond or actually improve their strength with repeated training. With a period of detraining, the muscles are actually more able to respond to new loads. We have talked many times about the fact that that type of chronic stress on the body just doesn't allow it to respond well to training after a while. So of course, with a period of time off, you can come back stronger. Another positive aspect to detraining is one that is psychological in nature. There are many, many studies that show that there is a psychological benefit to taking time off from training. People in those studies report less stress, their cortisol levels go down. It is well established that taking time off can allow athletes to come back to their sport refreshed and ready to go. So this is not the end of the world. However, we're human, and we can pretty much mess up anything if we try. So without further ado, here's three things that you can do to mess up the benefits that you'll gain from taking time off. The first way that you can mess this up is to equate fitness for your sport with a lean body. If you make weight loss a goal, you're screwing it up. Fitness for sport, or fitness in general, is not contingent on body weight, body mass, body fat percentage. There is a serious lack of scientific material that equates health and or fitness with body size. And if you do participate in a sport that requires drastic alterations in your natural body size, shape, or body fat percentage, maybe you have to think about your motivation for participating in that sport and whether or not it is healthy for you to continue to do so. Remember that lean bodies are a cultural preference, and they do not always equate with health. The second way you can mess this up is to try to come back to your sport when you're not fully recovered, AKA, you haven't gotten your period back. I can't even with this. Believe it or not, I actually know of people who are kind of skirting this issue as we speak. I don't want to call anyone out, but I will tell you this. You can run, but you can't hide. You will crash and burn eventually. I do understand that this is very, very difficult and very sensitive for some people. I have made a million and one mistakes during this process, and I do not judge you if this is where you are right now. I also will be here for you when you fall. The number three way you can mess this up is to fall back on old nutrition and training habits. It didn't work for you before, it's not gonna work for you now. This might be a time for you to consider the advice of a professional, like a nutritionist, who can help you sort of figure out what you should be eating instead of what you used to eat. And I think I said I was gonna do three ways you can mess this up, but I have another one. The fourth way you can mess this up is to equate your athletic performance with your success as a human. Please be patient with yourself. Your athletic performance really has no bearing on who you are inside. And if you start going down this path, the vicious cycle begins. This is total BS. Don't fall into this trap. Happy byproducts of detraining can also be things like learning how to get a life. For me personally, one of the hardest things and scariest things about not running as much or not running at all anymore was trying to figure out who I was, what I wanted to do, what I enjoyed spending my time doing, what goals I had. So for those of you who are going through this temporary lapse in training, you have to consider it as a time for you to get to know yourself better. The message I just want you to hear today is that I understand that the idea of not doing your sport and not training, not exercising is terrifying. I understand that you have legitimate concerns, physiological concerns based in science that you do not want to let go of. But the truth of the matter is that this very difficult moment in your life could turn out to be one of the most beneficial. The hope is that you will, in the future, if and when you do come back to your sport, work in periods of lower volume in your training, understand the benefits of periodization, and stop things before they start going down the wrong road. Okay, enough preachy-preachy. I have to show you something awesome. So it's a total coincidence that I'm wearing my glasses today. It's actually kind of early in the morning and I just didn't feel like putting my contacts in yet. But it is sort of serendipitous because I can show you what my mom gave me the other day. I mean, seriously, right? Anyway, I hope that this video took a little bit of the stress and pressure off you, gave you compelling reason to embrace the time off. Thank you so much for following me on Instagram, and thank you for finding me on Facebook. Don't forget that you can download a copy of the ebook from the A Case of the Jills website. I am so close to 1,000 subscribers, so if you do like this video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe. Have a great week wherever you are, and I will see you again soon. Thanks for watching.